Hello, my name is Dr. Gemma Coxon, and today I'm going to be talking about some work we've been doing on the Endows project. It's focused on hydrological modelling, intercomparison, guidance, and recommendation. This work is done in collaboration with academics at CEH, the Centre for Ecology and Hydrology, and also at the University of Bristol. So the aims and objectives of the hydrological modelling in Endows is the fact that during the droughts and water scarcity programme, a wealth of hydrological model output was produced using a real variety of different approaches, including different models, different setups. And the aim of this part of Endows is to integrate and compare the many different hydrological modelling approaches and their outputs. And make relevant recommendations for drought modelling to water supply companies, regulatory bodies, and academics. So the key research questions that we're really interested in this piece of work is how well do our models simulate drought behaviour that we're interested in? What do the models do differently to produce these simulations? And do these differences matter when informing decision support and drought management? So what we've been doing so far is we've taken all of the outputs across the droughts and water scarcity program, and we've collated a common set of catchments, i.e., a set of catchments where all the models have been run. And in total, there are 110 common catchments. In the map on the bottom left, you can see the locations of all the gauges, those are the circles, and then the outlines of the catchments in grey. And the colours of the circles are the Q95, the 95th percentile of flow in millimetres per day. The two plots on the right, the two histograms, are essentially showing that we're covering a wide diversity of hydrologic and climatic variability across Great Britain. So in orange is the histograms from our common in terms of annual rainfall and the base flow index, i.e. the proportion of flow that's coming from groundwater sources. And you can see that we're covering quite a wide diversity, so these catchments essentially are a good representation of catchments across Great Britain. The second thing that we've been doing is ensuring a consistent calibration between the models. So our models are calibrated to provide the best fit to observed flows. And here what we've been doing to ensure that our models are as comparable, or our model outputs are comparable as possible, we've been using exactly the same calibration techniques for two of the models. That's GR4J and the dynamic top model. Finally, the final thing that we've been doing, we have collated a list of metrics used by the hydrological modelling teams and chose four metrics to evaluate the models against. So this is a really important part of the hydrological modelling intercomparison, is how should we evaluate our models and say how good they are in different catchments. So we collated a massive list of metrics that we'd all evaluated our models against, and then we chose four essentially. One focused on high flows and more of a commonly used hydrological model metric, which is the Nash Sutcliffe efficiency. But then obviously we focused more on droughts and low flows. So we also used log Nash Sutcliffe efficiency, absolute percent bias to focus more on the water balance aspects. And then the low flow volume as well, which are highlighted in red. And we calculated these four metrics for all ensemble members from 1962 to 2015, from each hydrological model for all 110 common catchments. Just a couple of caveats that impact the results that I'm presenting today. Firstly, the models, one of the big points of comparison is the models don't actually use the same input data. They use slightly different rainfall products and also quite different potential evapotranspiration products. So that's something that does affect the results. We have three different models that I'm presenting results from today. And grid to grid only has one run compared to thousands of runs for dynamic top model and GR4J. So a direct comparison that I'm showing you is actually a little bit unfair on grid to grid because they only have one simulation to test against, whereas we've directly calibrated to particular output flows. So it's likely that grid to grid won't be quite as good as a model calibrated to each catchment. And so the third point is that metrics are calculated against observed data. Now for dynamic top model and GR4J, we calibrate our model simulations to this observed data to get a reasonable fit to the flow that was observed at the gauge. However, grid-to-grid simulates natural flows. So again, the model results will look a little bit different for heavily impacted or managed catchments, where the natural flows will be very different to the observed. Final point is that currently we don't have any results from the Drive project, which was also part of the Droughts and Water Scarcity program, but these will be added in due course. So in terms of the results, this is a very busy slide, but I will talk you through it. And so in the top panel, you have Nash Sutcliffe efficiency. Each point represents a gauge. Yellow denotes good model performance, blue denotes poor model performance. And what we've done here is the squares are benchmark catchments, i.e. catchments that we believe to be not as heavily impacted by human influences compared to the rest. And the circles are non-benchmark catchments. Again, just to pick up on the fact that, you know, we do have some slight differences in terms of what models produce in terms of output. And on the bottom panel is log NSE. So this is more focused on the low flows. So firstly, actually, the models are doing really well overall across, you know, a large proportion of the catchments in Great Britain. You know, they're simulating a wide variability of hydrologic and climatic diversity and producing good simulations. However, there are a couple of key things that we can really note from these plots. So firstly, all the models tend to perform not as well in northeast Scotland. A couple of reasons why we think this might be. It might be due to water storage in reservoirs or because of snow melt contributions. Currently, none of the models have a snow model in them, and this is something that we definitely want to look at in the future. Secondly, all the models perform better in the west of the country, so in wetter, generally wetter catchments, which isn't overly surprising, but the best model results are kind of found in the west of England and Wales. And finally, the biggest model differences are really found in the southeast. So this is where grid-to-grid and dynamic top model tend to struggle in terms of reproducing observed flows, and actually GR4J does very well in these catchments. And if we delve into the model results a bit further, we can see that if we look at the bias, we can sort of see some reasons for this difference. So again, each of the points show a gauge, and we've got bias percent in the top panel and low flow volume in the bottom panel. And here the blue colour shows that the model is overestimating the water flows, and the red colour shows that the model is underestimating water flows. So in the southeast, we can see that both grid-to-grid and dynamic top model are just too wet. We're producing too much flow in our simulations compared to GR4J. Grid-to-grid tends to then underestimate the flows kind of in the west and the north of Great Britain. And there are some really good reasons for this. So GR4J has a parameter that you can calibrate that essentially defines intercatchment water flows, and essentially is a water loss or a water gain from the model. So they have a parameter that they can tune in the model that essentially means they can lose as much or as little water in the time series as they need to be able to fit the flows. Now, dynamic top model and grid to grid both maintain water balance. And so essentially what's happening is we just don't have enough water loss from the model given the rainfall inputs and the PET outputs. So this explains the differences. So the outputs being produced from this work, so we've produced a common set of hydrological model outputs and metrics. We're also currently producing a guidance document summarising our findings and recommendations, and a protocol of the model comparison, including all workflows, and some model fact sheets, so that if you wanted to read up more in terms of what processes are in which models, or how they were calibrated, or what input data they used, you could use these fact sheets to help answer those questions. However, we've still got a lot of work to do. So over the next 6 months, really what we're going to be doing is delving deeper into the ensemble results. So the results I've shown you today are just simply for the best run. But GR4J and Dynamic Top Model actually have ensembles of model simulations. So in the box plots below, you can see three different catchments, and the box plots essentially show the range of model results from the ensemble. In blue is GR4J, in red is Dynamic Top Model, and then the dot is grid-to-grid that has one model simulation. We also need to dig deeper into the reasons for good, poor model performance and link this better to catchment characteristics. So I gave a few reasons earlier on as to why we were seeing good or poor model performance, but we need to delve into this further. The final step of this project is, do these differences matter when informing decision support and drought management? So, okay, we see that our model performances are different in different places. We have different evaluation metrics, but actually how does this matter? How much does this matter? So we'll be calculating a standardized stream flow index, Q95, and other map drought metrics to really see how different the models are, the results are between the models. So in summary, we've produced a common set of hydrological model outputs and metrics from the wealth of hydrological model output that has been produced during the droughts and water scarcity program. And we've started to understand the reasons for differences between these models from the best runs. Next, we will be delving into the ensemble data and better understanding reasons for good or poor model performance. We'll be calculating drought metrics to see how these differences matter when informing decision support and drought management. And finally, what we're also keen to do is to make comparisons between the research grade models that I've presented today and selected operation models in collaboration with key stakeholders. So better understanding how these research grade models sort of match up compared to what's being used to make drought decisions in Great Britain. If you'd like to get involved or would like to know more, please contact myself at the email below or Helen Gavin. Thank you.